Hello there. In this video, we are going to create a clear and complete overview of the complex problem situation we analyze for ourselves, so we understand the situation we are in much better, but just as important, also for the other actors involved. It makes a meeting with them and talking about the complex problem situation so much easier. In the last few videos, you've encountered several problem analysis techniques. We started by making an actor analysis. Then we defined problem statements for all actors involved. Remember the dilemma we found for every actor? We also made goal trees. And most recently, we constructed a causal diagram. So we have wonderful material, but how do we relate it so it can help to get a complete overview of the complex problem situation we analyze? We started our complex problem analysis with identifying the actors involved. One of these actors we considered the owner of the problem. It can be you, analyzing your own complex situation. You can also be the manager or consultant who works for a client, and that client is the problem owner. By talking to all the actors and asking them many questions, you constructed problem statements for all of them. And by constantly asking the why question, we were able to distract the main goals for all stakeholders. With the help of these main goals, we were able to create goal trees for all actors, by constantly asking the what is this question. We defined more abstract higher goals into more concrete sub-goals. At the bottom of all these goal trees, we found the criteria, on the basis of which all potential solutions to your complex problem situation will be compared to each other later on in the analysis. Combining all criteria from all the different actors and all their goal trees gives you a large set of criteria. You come to a practical and useful set of criteria by choosing between them. By making the first choice yourself, you come up with an initial set of criteria. Where possible, you discuss this set with all the actors involved. This way, you get an agreement on the set of criteria you will use in your further analysis. This could be a small set of 4 criteria, but it could also be a large set of 200. For your first analysis, we think it is better to consider a relatively small set. Later on, when you master the techniques much better, you can always expand your analysis and include as many criteria as you think is useful. As the criteria represent those elements in the problem field that all actors involved find important, it becomes very interesting to know what factors influence these criteria. Therefore, we made our problem field, that is, the complex situation we are analyzing, more explicit by representing it in relevant factors. This gives us a causal diagram. Some of the factors in the causal diagram influence other factors in the diagram, but these factors themselves are not influenced by anything. So there is nothing the actors can do to change them. These factors only have output and no input. We call these external factors. They are an important source of uncertainty in our complex problem situation. We deal with this uncertainty in our scenario analysis later on. The diagram that we have now created defines the problem area. So we can start thinking about potential solutions, that is, alternatives to influence the criteria. In other words, what actions can an actor take that influence our complex problem situation such that the criteria will change in the desired direction? We do this in 2 ways. We try to add the potential solutions our actors came up with to the diagram. If they can be related, they might be potential solutions. If they cannot be related, it means they cannot influence the criteria and therefore cannot be a potential solution. But also the other way around. We can find potential solutions by asking us the question, what measures can we think of that influence one or more factors in the causal diagram? Anything that can change a factor will, via the causal links in the diagram, also influence the criteria. So it might be something that adds to solving your complex problem. Might be, we don't know yet. But we need to list all these possibilities in order to later find out how good they are. What we have created now is called a problem diagram. If well constructed, it contains all the basic elements every actor needs to know about the problem. This diagram is a very powerful communication tool between you and all the other actors.
Hello, I'm Will Thyssen, and I'm the head of the Policy Analysis Department in the Faculty of Technology, Policy and Management. Our research in policy analysis covers a broad set of fields, including energy, water management, and climate adaptation. When I think of using a system or problem diagram, I go back to my experiences as a practicing policy analyst. And what I often got called into were messy situations where some people, some stakeholders came up with solutions. They wanted to implement a plan that they had. Others were talking about problems. Yet others were talking about an ideal world, wishes, and fourth or fifth parties were talking about, yes, but the world is more complex and there are other things around. And in those situations, the problem diagram, working it out, was extremely helpful in order to connect things to each other, to create order in the mess, to think about, okay, what are the problems, what are the criteria, what are the gaps between the wishes and the actual situation, what are the means or alternatives, and how do they relate to the criteria, what are exogenous factors. In my experience, doing that systematic problem analysis helped a lot to get a story that would be accepted by all and would also be consistent.
Let's look at Helen again, this time for the problem diagram you just heard Alexander and Will talk about. We will continue where we ended in the last video, where we drew Helen's causal diagram. This is, as you might remember, Helen's causal diagram representing her complex problem situation. Her personal problem statement is how to throw a good party without causing too much nuisance. Notice that in this simple example there are only two criteria. Helen wants to have fun with her party and the neighbors preferring it to be quiet. Also, the rest of the diagram is simple, only two external factors and five other factors. Remember, from the causal diagram it shows Helen's friends are very simple people who are only satisfied when they drink a lot in a noisy environment. No offense to Helen and her friends, this will do for what it is, a simple example. Now, let's look for alternatives for Helen's complex problem situation. We're looking for everything that is capable of changing the numerical value of the criteria. So, every action that influences one of the factors in the diagram, no matter how small, also influences the criteria. And when these actions do that, they can be a potential solution or a partial solution to the problem. In other words, they are an alternative. This means that in this case, Helen must ask herself the question, how can I change the amount of guests, the attention on Facebook, the number of consumed beverages, the number of drunk guests, the inside noise level, or how can I directly change the number of satisfied guests, or the outside noise level? The possible answers to all these questions are the many potential solutions, that is, the many alternatives for solving the complex problem at hand. So, what would you think if you were Helen? Possible alternatives that influence the criteria could be limiting the maximum amount of people allowed to enter, raise the alcohol price, or, for example, improve the isolation of the house. However, one can immediately see that the first two alternatives will negatively influence the amount of satisfied guests at the party, while this was the most important criterion for Helen. However, it is too soon to judge. Just collect the potential solutions, we will find out about their usefulness later on in the analysis. In this case, Helen just considered some first three alternatives that came to mind. There are many more, of course. However, one alternative that is often forgotten is doing nothing. This is the so-called zero option. Often we are so keen on finding an alternative that we forget to consider the consequences of doing nothing at all. Maybe whatever party Helen organizes, it will cause so much nuisance to the neighbors that they will call the police and Helen will ruin her relationship. Maybe in that case it would have been better for all parties that the party would have never been organized at all. Apart from not forgetting the zero option of not doing anything, also we don't want to overlook any other important alternatives. Therefore, looking at the problem in a group setting is very useful, either with some of the actors involved or with some friends, colleagues or experts. Everyone in the group will have a different experience, expertise and viewpoints on the complex problem situation. Therefore, the chance is larger to end up with an extensive list of both very realistic and some out-of-the-box ideas. Several methods exist for productive group sessions for the generation of alternatives, like brainstorming, brain writing, brain sketching or mind mapping. All these methods have in common that no one initially judges the alternatives that come up because this blocks the creative process.
Hi everybody, time for action again. Before you start working on your own case, I suggest to study section 2.5 in your book. When you have studied that, design a problem diagram for your own problem situation. Make sure everything is in there. Start from the actors, their criteria, and the causal diagram. Identify the external factors. Also, show how potential alternatives influence at least one factor in a diagram. When your diagram is finished, do you have any ideas on how you're going to use it? Discussing it with your actors, talking to your supervisors, or presenting it to your clients? There are many possibilities. Finally, a few common mistakes we all make when constructing problem diagrams. In a problem diagram, it is essential that you combine all analysis that you have carried out so far. All these analyses should fit nicely together. Dilemmas for problem statements should come back in your goal trees. And the criteria from your goal trees should be a start for your causal diagram. It is not at all that difficult to make a good problem diagram. However, often you see that the different analyses do not fit so well. And then, suddenly, creating a problem diagram becomes much more complex. Most common is that the criteria in the problem diagram do not originate from the goal trees you made earlier. The same happens with the alternatives. There should be a clear link between them and your causal diagram. By now, you have screened your initial list of alternatives. You have also made a few combinations of alternatives, which should now be in your problem diagram. An alternative that often misses is the so-called zero alternative. Doing nothing in a problem situation sounds like a crazy solution, but it can sometimes be better than doing actually something. Even when it's clear that doing nothing is no serious option, it is still very useful to have some sort of reference. What happens when I do nothing? And what will happen when I actually do implement an alternative? Good luck with your analysis and see you around!